My name's Neil Burridge. Welcome to my sword corner. Over the last 20 years, I've made a lot of these, I've seen a lot of swords in museums, and I've learned a lot, and I'd like to share it with you. Right, welcome back for another video. We're going to look, or carry on with the Wilburton sword and Wilburton sword hoard. Remember last time we looked at a sword I made for Bucks County Museum. Really beautiful sword, and I kind of waxed lyrical about Wilburton hoards. So I've made a Wilburton hoard based on two of the better hoards. The main one is the Blackmore hoard, or Selborne Blackmore hoard. I think there's even another name for it as well, but it just completely blinged up. So I've been beavering away making loads of bling to illustrate the point, shiny. I was lucky enough to work, there was a councillor in Borden town who was interested. He wanted to open the museum and create a whole load of stuff to bring the local history to life. And I got involved in the project and had to make some stuff, and it was pretty good. I learned a lot from it. It's the only piece of the hoard from Blackmore. That's it, the Blackmore Selborne hoard that is not in Britain. It was sold separately by one of the family, and it's now in the Metropolitan Museum in New York, I believe. Quite elaborate. It's not the biggest spear in the pile, but it's one that just caught my imagination because I think its proportions are absolutely incredible. It's called a lunate spear, and we'll look at it in a minute. Also in the Blackmore hoard, remember we're looking at Wilburton hoards, so we're just giving a quick glance. They seem to happen sort of in this corridor between somewhere around 1000, 1150, 900 BC. They vary whether they're early or later Wilburton hoards. The Blackmore hoard is quite interesting because it crosses over Wilburton to Ewart Park. It finds the two different sword types. So they kind of, I think, transition. But it's quite an incredible collection of odds and sods in it. I think there's 22 swords. I might got wrong, and I don't want to look under the table at my list because I can't remember. A lot of swords, lots and lots of spears. Absolutely huge amount of spears. But they had these ones with ribbon in, the terracing, which are particularly beautiful. And they come in all different sizes. And the terracing repeats on the lunate spears as well. So they're pretty fabulous. They obviously had a very skilled craftsperson at the time working on these. Also, I think we had lots of small spears as well in the hoard. Lots of rings in this hoard, which I think was they're only about 5 mil thick, 6 mil thick, 30, 40 millimeters across. And I think they were sword suspension, which I think I mentioned last time. So there's a lot of these as well. It's, research in this has been quite interesting. There's kind of discussions in earlier papers. They call these javelin heads, and they call these spearheads, but I think they're basically one of the same, so I'm gonna stick with spearheads. It's probably the most common type of spearhead you see across the British Isles. They vary in length, classic sort of leaf form with a socketed tube. Some are longer sockets, some are shorter, blades get longer, but they're the same, follow the same thread. And ultimately you're sort of looking at something this size, even though this is actually one from Scotland, but I'll talk about that later. So quite interesting. So Wilburton hordes have lots of swords, lots of spears. And somebody discussed the point there might be a ratio between the number of spears to the number of swords. It's fairly constant, which is quite interesting. It's a noisy day on the farm. Seemed to be a lot of banging and thumping, but we'll have to live with it. So there's quite a lot of repetition in spears and swords of different types. Mainly, they all belong to this. So it is busy today. So this is the a blade form. This one's sort of classic Wilburton, big leaf bladed sword. Remember earlier I said the difference, if you cut the handles off these swords, that the blade form is almost the same through all the York Park Wilburton type swords. They're very, very similar. Once they've lost their handles, it's very hard to tell which way they go. The handles is the main key to their identification. The way they were cast, whether they were cast through the handle or through the tip, is the main reason why the handles are the way they are. So you wouldn't be able to cast a Wilburton sword through a skinny handle like this, whereas the later York Parks you would. Anyway, so the sword we looked at from Ivanhoe Beacon was based on this one here. I've just coloured them up to make them look like the originals. Quite an interesting thing, but they're very stylish, and I've always been, there's something that's later York Parks are very beautiful, but they lose that kind of Art Deco styling. So, and also the interesting thing about the hoards are the swords tend to be broken, as in put across a knee and broken up that way. They're not broken in the same way quite often that you'd break them for a founder's hoard, if you can understand. And one of the things I was reading up on was that the idea that they were sort of the swords of the vanquished, that when your enemy was beaten, you'd break up their swords and throw it in the lake, which carries on in Northern Europe. They find hoards. We honestly can't tell. There was another hoard called the Black, I've forgotten the name of it now. I'm a bit rusty today. Bloody Pool hoard, that was it. Which was lots of these very beautiful spears broken up, and a new object we've not talked about so far is the ferrules, which go on the far end of the spear. They give them a different name in America. I think they call them butt spikes or serrutas in the sort of Mediterranean world, but here we just call them ferrules because they like footed, and they vary a bit. This one's from Hoard in Shropshire, so I just brought it in to kind of elaborate on there. So this would be the other end of the shaft, so it gives you an idea of the actual proportions of spear shafts. If they're coming out here and they're tapering down to here, the Wilburton swords are interesting because it's the transition when earlier spears, I'm going to put that down, this is an earlier spear. It wouldn't have turned up in a Wilburton hoard. But earlier spear like this, the transformation is the size. Once you get to the Wilburton hoards, the spears are starting to get smaller. They're no longer absolutely massive as they were from earlier times. And the blades are getting bigger. So you almost see this transition, a tipping point between big spears and swords getting bigger and bigger. There's a sort of transition point just before the Wilburton period. So once we're into this. Spears are still very current, and there's lots of them. The Wilburton hoard has absolutely staggering amounts of spears in them, and I find them quite interesting. They're almost like a throwaway item. Some of the theories are the spears were short stick spears that they either throw at people or just use them at very close range, or blah blah blah. I honestly don't know. It's not really my speciality, but it's interesting. There's lots and lots of these. So the number of spears in some of the hordes is staggering. It's like 50, 60 spears quite often. But they always seem to have an elegance about them, which I find quite interesting. All Wilburton sword hordes have some axes, some pal staves with loops, and some socketed ones. But another interesting is, I'll do this one for this one here, is the japes, which go on the end of the scabbards. And it seems to be the smaller the sword, the bigger the chape. So you get these very long, this is only a small one really, you could add another 3-4 inches to this one in Wilburton stuff to get a chape that goes on the end of the scabbard. So I think gradually as the swords get bigger, the chapes get smaller. So if you found this, you'd probably be looking for a smaller sword, and if you found this one, you'd be looking for a bigger sword. So we're going to push that in there. So yeah, there's still some stuff in there. So it gives you an idea. So this decorated the end of the scabbard, and these are quite common. Towards Scotland, they stay in use right well into the Ewart Park phase. So they cross over, and chapes, they're comparatively rare, but I find them very interesting. So this is going to be longer lived up in Scotland with the more exotic Ewart Park swords that they develop there. So that's quite interesting. It's called a chape. They're insanely thin. They're quite often 0.5 millimetre in thickness. And for some reason, they use a very high tin alloy to cast them, which helps them cast, but it must make them very brittle, because the alloy is called chape metal, I think, in the books, and it's got tin content and a lead content, so it's up to about sort of 17% white metal, and it physically rings when you drop it. It's quite beautiful. The plate scrap hoards that come with the chapes, it's where they have like a flat mould, a stone mould with ribs cut in it, and they just pour the metal over the surface, and then they must either pick it up and drop it in water or break it up with a hammer. It's very brittle, but it seems to work well with this. And I'm not sure if it's the same stuff used in the ferrules. That's an interesting thought just come into my head. So the hoards fall into their, I think it's 1150 down to 800, I think. And there's lots of them. There's many, many hoards, and I tried to memorize them, but they're huge numbers. They're also parallel by a slightly earlier type that was more and more spears, and you get these huge hordes of spears, which I'm going to follow up in a later video, make it more interesting rather than introduce it now. The Bloody Paul Hoard was quite interesting. I was lucky enough to do a project with the curator at Edinburgh Historic Scotland, Matt Knight, where we cast lots of these and lots of other items, and then he smashed them all to bits. And it was quite interesting because we were trying to replicate bronze breakage, and when we broke these up, we got exactly the same shapes as the one in Exeter Museum. Absolutely quite striking, just by heating them up to the right temperature, get them to break. So there was a deliberate method to the breaking of some of these hoards, which is quite fascinating. So some hoards, the swords were placed over your knee, broken up. And other hoards, the metal was heated up till it's bright red and then passed over an edge and hit with a hammer and broke into small bits. So it's complex. The Bloody Boar hoard is, it's quite an interesting one to see. The thing I couldn't get over was the elegance of the castings. I mean, I've done my best to try and rival them, but they've still got the edge on me by a long way. The beautiful quality in the thinness of the cross sections through here. The location of the coring in these spears is quite profound stuff. No decoration on the Bloody Paw hoard, but we're going to look at the quick decoration on the Selborne spears. Just a quick look at the decoration, and then I'll... So, the Blackmore Hoard, the spear decoration, has this circular motif on some of the basal parts of the spears, and then the parallel lines. Quite unusual. The biggest spear in the hoard was probably as big as the one I showed you earlier from the earlier period, another sort of 4 inches over this. And it's really damaged. They've struck it against other weapons. So whether that's combat damage or whether it's ritual sacrifice, I honestly don't know. But it is quite beautiful to see. So I'm showing you here. So you've got the terracing and you've got these decoration lines down the outside. I'm going to talk about spears in another film, so I won't go too deeply into it. But I just thought they're an incredibly beautiful thing. The same with this here. The terracing runs down. We'll insert a picture of... there's a plantain, and I'm sure it was the inspiration behind the terracing on the spears. There's no structural reason for it. It's purely an art thing. And when you see the plantain compared to here, it's absolutely beautiful. Big hoards, really stylish stuff. I just absolutely love the kind of Wilburton sword art deco feel there is to it. It's definitely worth looking into. There are so many hoards, I can't get the names into my head. The Islam hoard up near Ely, I think it's 6,200 pieces and it weighs a staggering 65 kilos. That is a lot of bronze. I think when they found it, they're probably just like incredible. And it's been looked at by lots of people over lots of times. But the interesting thing about these hoards is all the oddities they have in them, because they paint a fascinating picture. So I'm hoping to go and see that one take somebody with me and study it, because it's the oddities that paint in all the missing parts of the Bronze Age. It's not all swords and spears. There's lots and lots of tiny little trinkets. Anyway, I try to do my best there and make Wilburton hoards look a bit more interesting. And it also gives you an idea of what goes with what sword goes with what spear. Because you quite often see reenactors now put an early Bronze Age dagger with a late Bronze Age sword and a middle Bronze Age spear, which is kind of nonsense because there's something like 1,000 years between them. So... what can you do? Anyway, I'm doing my best. Anyway, Wilburton Hoards, thank you.
We're going to be testing the Wilburton. This is from Neil Burridge. This is a beautiful example. He did an excellent job. I love the sword. We tested it out in another video with the rolled wet newspaper. We used extremely thick rolls and it cut immensely well. We don't even know how to describe it. For the size of the sword, this shape is a cutting edge. Ah! And I would say we pierced our skull and went clean in. Ooh, that's nasty. Neil, we are so happy that you sent us this. The blade performed excellent. I am very, very impressed with this. I'm sorry, but that is a decap. And for a sword that's not that heavy, but let's say it's blade heavy, it's not heavy, it performed excellent. Cut the top of the skull off. We cut into the skull. We cleaved through the jaw area into the eye here, like into the skull, which I was very impressed with as well for the size of the blade. But this is what's truly amazing. We cut the arteries in the neck, as you can see up top here, a clean cut through, and it sliced in and up. And then we came back and took the head clean off. So, I mean, this right here, just this PVC tubing, is a lot tougher than actual artery. So, I mean, that is amazing. With the 20% ballistics gelatin and our coconut skull, the bronze performed extremely well. Held up, not much bending. It performed extremely well. Thank you so much, Neil, for sending us the Wilburton. It's my favorite sword now, I gotta tell you, out of all the bronze weapons.
I don't monetize my films. The idea is to share my knowledge with you. So if you want to support me, you can buy me a cup of coffee in the link below. And if you could like, share, and hit the subscribe button, that'd be fantastic. Thank you.
Right, we're ready.
Right.